is a great disturbance in the Force. We have a new enemy. George Lucas, the one who created the prequels and the special editions. There is a new threat that can destroy us. The special deluxe edition, Lucas Cut. A version of the original trilogy that is said to be Lucas's final cut before reverting to Disney. This cut could destroy us.
The struggles will view. The fans will be a powerful ally.
Yes. Yes. And the dark side will grow stronger. All we need is a team. Can it be done?
I know just who to call.
Ah, guys, the Force is strong with us. The upcoming Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens, coming out. I can't wait. I'm so hyped! You know what, guys? I think this is a great time with the upcoming Star Wars Episode 7 to take a moment to just talk about the greatest saga, three of the greatest movies of all time. Of course, the Star Wars original trilogy and the prequels. So,
Rogue Squadron, this is Jared standing by.
Cadillac standing by.
Here's Kills, ready to beam you up.
Rashawn standing by.
Let's hop in and talk about the 1977 original Star Wars. Alright, so, funny story. I actually grew up with the prequels, but when I saw Episode 3 in the theaters, my mind was blown that night. I said, what happens next? My mom got me the original Star Wars trilogy, and that entire weekend, I spent the entire weekend watching three of the greatest films ever put on the screen. Directed by George Lucas. The story about, honestly, the trailers say it, a boy, a girl, and a universe. You're introduced to characters of C-3PO, R2-D2, Princess Leia, Han Solo, Obi-Wan Kenobi,
and Vader, and the physical demeanor of how he looks like. How did you like him when he was on screen, or how did you feel his presence?
Well, he's obviously very scary, it's an eye of fire.
And I think that's the wrong movie. I think you're thinking about Sauron from Lord of the Rings.
Am I? Because I'm pretty sure he was in Return of the New Hope.
And of course, our main character up the journey, Luke Skywalker. As he's a farm boy who's trying to escape from his reality, which leads him onto an adventure led by Obi-Wan Kenobi, as they go off and embark on a journey in a galaxy far, far away, as they fight the Galactic Empire led by Darth Vader. So, let's just be honest. Everybody here has seen Star Wars, right?
Well, I guess I'd have to say Attack of the Jedi when he's waking up with New Hope, and then he walks into the Two Towers. I guess that would be my favorite one.
Keels, you're seeming a little, odd with that response.
I'm not gonna lie, when I was younger, I wasn't that into it. I really didn't appreciate Star Wars until I got a little bit older. Until I was like, I'm gonna say 10-ish. Because I first saw Star Wars when I was like, maybe 6 or 7. I was just looking at it. I wasn't really paying attention. I was just looking at the screen, but it's a good story, honestly.
Alright. To start off with the 1977 Star Wars, A New Hope. The one movie I would say started everything and bring a new presence to the science fiction genre. And A New Hope is one of the best films I've ever seen. To a point. So you have...
To a point?
To a point.
Elaborate.
I'm elaborating on the good parts of New Hope and the bad parts that have only been ruined by the later sequels. The inconsistency in certain things.
I mean, technically it's Lucas's fault because he should use the originals as a template and a blueprint to do the prequels, but he decided to rewrite history. So that's the fault of the prequels, not the original trilogy, which are perfection.
It was a great way to start out the Star Wars trilogy, even though it was technically the fourth installment, but at the same time it was the first Star Wars movie. It told a great story from a galaxy far, far away.
Right. And the set designs were awesome looking, right?
I guess so, yeah. I mean, what am I supposed to do?
It was groundbreaking special effects for 1977. George Lucas spent his last just trying to, like, make the product designs and spent hours, almost went to the hospital just to do it.
Really?
Yeah. He was determined to finish Star Wars.
The characters of Star Wars are great. I like how you got the beginning, you get Luke and his young kid trying to figure out what he should do in his life, and then going out and meeting someone who knew some of his past, or his father's past, his family origin, and then learning that there are Jedis, they actually do exist, and that he is one with the Force.
It's a good sci-fi space story. Darth Vader, one of the most iconic villains in film, I would say.
Except the part where you have Darth Vader fighting Obi-Wan Kenobi and Obi-Wan just disappearing.
How could you not feel bad when Obi-Wan Kenobi died?
I did feel bad when he died, though. That hurt. That hurt me. Yeah, because I remember seeing that in the theaters. I was like,
no!
No, wait. No, I'm thinking of Qui-Gon Jinn. Never mind. You get over there, buddy?
He was a good mentor towards Luke. Just like he was for his father. Obi-Wan taught him the Force. He did what he needed to do. He didn't really have to die, but in order for Luke to get to where he is now, he kind of had to die. He was like a self-sacrifice kind of thing.
What about the characters of Star Wars?
The characters of Star Wars are great.
How do you feel about Princess Leia?
She wasn't really one of my favorites.
Princess Leia,
post and after slave costume.
I really liked her in the slave costume.
Talk about that.
Hey, you can talk about Slave Leia.
I'm not crazy about it like you are.
I like where they had her, as in, like, her character was a little bit flat in the very first one. I would say, like, she developed more as she went along, became more of a badass, as in, like, you guys just got to see her actually do more things. Well, it's like once you first hear, you're kind of thinking, like, oh, it's the princess and the damsel in distress type thing.
Is she really, though? Because
I know, yeah, she
gets captured, but then, like, when they rescue her, she takes the blaster, like, somebody has to save our skins.
Exactly, like, she, like, once you got to that point, like, oh, you're not, like, first year, you think she's going to be the undeveloped type character, and she's going to be the princess, and she's going to be the damsel in distress, but yet once you get to her on the ship and everything else, like, you see, oh, she's not. She's going to be the badass. She's going to be the one helping them. She's not going to be the one in the back going to mess up everything.
All right, the cantina scene. Don't say that, for real. When we're in the bar, it's like,
with the ugly things playing their instruments.
That's a bit of an odd response, but it actually went this way. The cantina scene, classic moment where you first meet Han Solo, this dark scum and tyranny of the galaxy itself, and the music plays in, that's now seen as classical. Alien creatures, weird creatures. Fret not, you can go with either the original or special edition, but either way, deep down we all know, Greedo did not shoot first, it was Han.
He's the Klingon, the Oscar.
Yes, I bet you have.
I'm tired of everybody always making that assumption that he shot. Why? Why, Lucas?
I've been in arguments with people, I'm like, who shot first, who did this, who did that, and which is really the better one?
There isn't. It's the original. There is no Greedo shot first, Han shot. Han is the only one to shoot.
I know, shoots first, so I'm like, it gives you like a setting like, oh, you don't fuck with Han Solo.
Were they not ugly?
And then we change gears when we get into the trench run with the Death Star. It's just groundbreaking. The visual effects, the fact that you're in this escape and you actually feel the tension with each character as they slowly, one by one, die.
One by one.
And everyone's just like, oh, Luke's friends and everyone who's joined.
And the Biggs.
Oh, God.
And you have this faint of hope, and then suddenly, the ghost of Obi-Wan comes and tells Luke, use the Force.
And it's all up to Luke at the very end to use the Force and actually destroy the Death Star, which is a great scene.
The trench front was a pretty good mage in itself, but still leaving such a vulnerable spot. I mean, yes, it's a very small spot that hit, but still, like, patched up with some drywall or something. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like,
because the whole, like, premise...
Like, a shield on it or something. Like, that's such a vulnerable spot.
Yeah, because the whole premise was that the rebellion... The Princess Leia, in the beginning of the movie, she stole the planets of the Death Star and put it in the R2-D2, and they find out that they have this one flaw where it's the size of a womp rat. They could literally, like, they shoot it directly in this hole, the space station will blow up.
And of course, in this triumphant moment, when all hope seems to be lost, and Darth Vader has Luke in his scope, Han Solo comes swarming in and saves the day, so Luke can blow up the Death Star, and the rest is history. Changing gears from the last Star Wars film, The Empire Strikes Back stars the original cast members and introduces Billy Dee Williams as Lando Calrissian as they continue their journey. Now this time, the Empire is after the Rebellion for Revenge, were of course blowing up the Death Star, led by Luke Skywalker.
You said that was Return of the Jedi, or the Jedi Starts Again?
Definitely changing gears as a darker tone in the Star Wars saga, as we're introduced to new characters throughout the journey, like Boba Fett. This is the second film in the Star Wars original trilogy, and The Empire Strikes Back is personally not only my favorite film in the saga, but I consider it one of my favorite films, if not my favorite of all time. So, another one of the greatest cinematic characters, Yoda.
Yoda, that's my favorite Star Wars character, right next to R2-D2.
What do you guys have to say about
Yoda? He's been around for how many years would you say?
878 years.
Wow. About more than 800 years. He's the guy you want to go to and know about the Force. He taught Luke how to, and countless other Padawans, how to use the Force. I like the whole training scene when he had, when he was on Luke's back and running through the swamp to teach him how to use the Force. And I think one of my other favorite parts is when they were in Dagobah and Luke had to go face it, the dark side. There was a strong dark side of the Force within a certain area of Dagobah, and Luke had to go face that himself. I thought that was a good scene.
I would say is probably the most underestimated badass until episode 2.
That's the thing, like, the whole point that was established in Empire Strikes Back is that Yoda's this old mentor, and he's so powerful that he doesn't need the, like, a weapon like a lightsaber. Regardless of it being a Jedi's weapon, he's so powerful and one with the Force, and he chooses not to fight, that he's above that. And that's the beauty of it, his teachings, his quotable lines, do or do not, there is no try. But that's not even my favorite. I love the scene where he lifts up the X-Wing and just proves, it's like, that is why you fail. It's the ultimate burn in movie history. Even the opening shot with the AT-AT walkers attacking the Hoth base, I feel like that in some ways is more suspenseful than the trench run in the first Star Wars, because you actually have the peril of these characters that are dying one by one, and it doesn't end happily. The heroes lose.
It was a change of pace of seeing, like, wow, and just in scale of seeing them, and these guys, instead of, like, actually seeing ship-on-ship battles, you actually see AT-AT walkers, and you're seeing the ground troops and what they're trying to do in order to stop them, and just people just dying consistently, their whole entire base being destroyed, and them trying to escape, but also trying to take down the AT-AT walkers and the rest of the stormtroopers. Kind of like, Vader found you, it's time to go, but you need to fight in order to get away.
And of course, you have the romance between Han Solo and Princess Leia, which is actually believable. Wink, wink, Attack of the Clones. And you get to this moment that's improvised completely by the direction of Harrison Ford, where Carrie Fisher, where Princess Leia says,
I love you.
I know.
And then you get to movie's greatest plot twist of all time. You find out that Darth Vader is Luke's father.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
Now, the funny thing about this scene is that it was actually kept a secret from a lot of the cast members. It was purposely put a deleted page that said, "You don't know the truth, Obi-Wan killed your father." But Mark Hamill, Ivan Kushner, the director, and James Earl Jones, along with George Lucas, of course, who wrote it, were the only four who actually knew that Darth Vader was Luke's father. And they were told last minute, right before filming,
Vader fighting it out, going across the skyway on the platform, just going and fighting, and then seeing Luke's arm getting cut off, and Luke going back, being backed into a corner, then going and telling Vader, "You killed my father, that's why." Then Vader saying that, "No, I didn't kill your father, I am your father." It's just one of the most iconic scenes in Star Wars history, having Vader reveal that he is Luke's father, and Luke just not wanting to accept it.
Luke couldn't really handle the truth. It was a shocker to me, and once again, I know I've said it out so many times, iconic line.
And the great thing about, like, that scene is that Vader knows that this is his son that he's fighting, and he gives two shits that, "I don't care, you're either going to turn or you're going to die." And he just cuts off his son's hand.
The reason I think he was like that is because it reminded him of what he used to be, and Vader didn't want that kind of weakness from him.
Vader gives him the choice, "You're either going to turn or you're going to die," and then Luke self-consciously sacrifices himself by, like, committing suicide and just falling off of the, like, Trenton Cloud City, just, you know, he gets rescued, but still, he ultimately tries to commit suicide.
From her, you bitch!
Alright, and that leads us to the final chapter in the original Star Wars trilogy, Return of the Jedi, as we're introduced again to our young band of heroes and the Rebellion as they make one final effort to destroy the Empire once and for all. So, how do you guys feel about the Empire literally after its destruction, years later, creating a Death Star 2 with the same flaw in the trench run?
Doesn't make any sense to me. That's one of the things that really didn't make sense. Why make another Death Star with the same exact flaw and not fix that flaw? That made no sense to me whatsoever.
I mean, I guess you
can... I feel like that was a big plot hole.
I mean, I guess you can argue that, like, it was the Emperor's plan, which it was, to, like, as a trap, like, oh, we have the same flaw, and the whole point is that they thought that the Death Star 2 was not operational, but it was, but I'm pretty sure if Luke can beat it the first time, he can beat it the second time.
Well, so why risk it?
And it's bigger that time. They actually made the hole bigger. You can fit a whole ship in there and destroy it.
Didn't the whole ship go in there the second time?
The second time. It was even easier, actually.
Jabba the Hutt time in episode 6. When you have Luke coming in, walking, using the Force. Being able to see that Luke has mastered the Force to a point where he can do that himself is kind of awesome. And seeing him just walk in with his hood on and just making everything, using the Force on everything and everyone, and then kind of being unexpectedly falling into Jabba's trap a little bit.
Classic scene before they fight Jabba the Hutt. Wasn't that great, Keels?
Sarlacc pit. Is that when Captain Kirk was like throwing everybody in the little monster, right? That's the one, right? Because I remember that. And then Luke Skywalker, he was trying to find O'Hara, right? Right?
I swear that guy was going to eat me, to be honest. After seeing, didn't he eat like one of his servants or something?
He didn't eat one of his servants, but one of his servants fell into the Rancor pit. This one dancer, because she's a slave, tries to kill him,
right?
She tries to kill Jabba the Hutt by, like, getting the chain and choking him. So he just, like, pushes one button. She's in the Rancor pit. She gets eaten alive by the Rancor monster. And he, like, basically, as a remorse of her death, eats a slug / frog and says, "All right, off to the next one. Where's my entertainment?"
Now, I always wanted to ask this. Did he rape Leia?
Because
I feel like I've heard things. I'm not sure. Like, is that true or not?
I mean, when Leia's in the slave outfit, it's assumed that, like, I don't think that she was raped. But I think, to his amusement, he put it on her. So, I don't think Leia was raped. But she definitely was very uncomfortable in doing it against her will. But you know what the funny thing is? George Lucas, periodically throughout all three movies, like in the first Star Wars, he said to Carrie Fisher, "They don't wear underwear in space, so you shouldn't wear underwear on set." And then in Return of the Jedi, you know, like in Return of the Jedi, you get to it and George Lucas is like, "You know, I think we can make the bikini tighter and we don't have to show as much down there." And that's what led to the creation of the Slave Leia costume.
It's like he was being a perv.
And, the Ewoks. Do you like them? How do you feel about the Ewoks?
Now, are the Ewoks is that Chewbacca, or is that, like, the little Care Bear thing?
The Care Bears? They're Care Bears!
The Care Bears? You say Care Bears also?
Their faces are ugly.
I like
everything else, but their faces are kind of weird. It's like they got stuck with like free space or something. Alright, I do have something to say. How did the Ewoks defeat them when they just used spears and rocks? When they're up against guns and metal.
And the Emperor says himself, "I sent my best troops on Endor," and they get defeated. Yeah, you're right, by sticks and rocks. But I love the scene when the two Ewoks take the two tree branches and they take the axe, and one is on
that
one
was
side.
Smart. But
yeah,
that's the only thing I can find believable. But everything else, no, I can't.
These mini Care Bears, they're Care Bears. I don't know what anyone says. They're Care Bears.
They're not Care Bears.
Care Bears fighting stormtroopers and everyone else with sticks and rocks. And I'm like, what are these things?
And what makes the climax of Return of the Jedi my favorite is that you get this very powerful moment where Luke is fighting Darth Vader, his father, in the dark. And contrast with what he's feeling. You have one half of his face that's dark, one half of his face that's light. And Vader is taunting him. He's like, "Oh, well, you know, Obi-Wan failed, and I know that you have a sister. You know, if you won't turn the dark side, then perhaps she will." So you get to this moment where Luke just freaks out, clashes his saber with Vader, and gets to the point where he cuts off his arm. And a beautiful scene where the Emperor ultimately is seen as winning. Luke says,
"Never. I'll never turn to the dark side. You failed, Your Highness. I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Now, something that we haven't seen up to this point is the true nature and power of the Dark Sun before. So the Emperor electrocutes Luke and gets to the point to where he's about to die. And Vader is contrasting, and you can see the emotion in his eyes that are so blank, and in his movements, how sterile he is. And he's debating if he should listen to his master or save his son. And ultimately, he decides to save his son and fulfill the prophecy that was established in the prequels of the Chosen One destroying the Emperor.
Oh, classic. The revelation of Darth Vader turning to the good side. How did you feel about that, Keels? Because I felt powerful and triumphant when that happened.
Wait, when did this happen? I thought Darth Vader was always evil.
I've located the cover story.
I have located the essence of the Gaz Knight's rebels, Lord Vader.
Do you guys see that?
Guys, we have TIE fighters coming in fast.
Don't worry, guys, we have reinforcements coming. X-Wings will be here quickly.
X-Wings? Oh, are they mild or are they buffalo? Because I'm kind of hungry. And do they have blue cheese with them? Because I love blue cheese.
You get over there?
You act like you've never seen Star Wars.
I've seen all 8 of them. All 8. And I've seen the Christmas special, which was the best thing I've ever seen.
Kill, circle around.
Keels, just admit it, you've never seen Star Wars.
Alright, I've never seen it before.
You've never seen Star Wars?
What do you want me to do? They're so long and they're so boring.
And you, the Kindred of Mar look alike, has never seen Star Wars.
Keels, can you hear me?
Here.
Yeah, you got a TIE fighter on your right.